Romans chapter 13. Look with me briefly at verses 1 through 7. I thank God for those wonderful, blessings. Allowing God to use you in His service. It's a wonderful thing. Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 7. Trust that everyone has it. I'm reading from the New American Standard Version of the Bible. Once you have arrived at whatever translation you are using, you will find words similar to these. Every person is to be in subjection to the governing authority. There is no authority except from God, and those which exist are established by God. Therefore, whoever resists authorities has opposed the ordinance of God, and they who have opposed will receive condemnation upon themselves. Rulers are not a cause of fear for good behavior, but for evil behavior. Do you want to have no fear of authority? Do what is good, and you will have praise from the same. For it is a minister of God to you for good. But if you do what is evil, text says, be afraid. For it does not bear the sword for nothing. For it is a minister of God, an avenger who brings wrath on the one who practices evil. Therefore, it is necessary to be in subjection not only because of wrath, but also for conscience' sake. Because of this, you also pay taxes, for rulers are servants of God, devoting themselves to this very thing. Render to all what is due them, tax to whom tax is due, custom to whom custom is due, fear to whom fear is due, honor to whom honor is due. I want to preach this morning from the subject, the purpose of government. You may have your seats. Thank you very much, ushers. You're certainly too kind. The purpose of government. The purpose. Allow me to preface this message by informing you that this is a very difficult passage of scripture to deal with. It's difficult for various reasons. The primary reason that I believe that this passage is a difficult passage to deal with is because there are several different ways that people attempt to interpret what Paul is saying here. The purpose of government. Though there are several different ways that people interpret the passage, Paul's message is clear. The government in which you and I are citizens of does have a purpose. Purpose of government.
in Alabama, there was a pastor who was running late for his speaking engagement. Because this pastor in Alabama was running late for his speaking engagement, he found it necessary to drive 20 miles over the speed limit, zooming down the highway, going 20 miles over the speed limit, honking his horn at people who seemingly were keeping him from getting to where he needed to be. If honking his horn wasn't good enough, once this pastor drove past the person that he had just honked his horn at, he looked at them with a nasty look as if to say, "Please get out of my way." This pastor, running late for his speaking engagement, driving 20 miles over the speed limit, honking his horn at people, bobbing in and out of traffic, giving people nasty looks as he passed them by, all of a sudden had an epiphany. He realized that he was a pastor who was breaking the law by going 20 miles over the speed limit. This pastor was not only breaking the law by going 20 miles over the speed limit, but he was bobbing and weaving in and out of traffic, honking his horn at people who were obeying the law and giving them nasty looks as he passed them by. He realized that he was a pastor, but not only was he a pastor, he also realized that on the back bumper of his vehicle, there was a sticker that proclaimed, "I am a Christian." My Lord. The pastor was driving down the highway, doing 20 miles over the speed limit, honking his horn, bobbing in and out of traffic, giving people nasty looks as he passed them by. He was thinking to himself, "What must these people think about me?" This pastor with a bumper sticker proclaiming that I am a Christian, doing the only thing that he thought was necessary to do. The pastor pulled over to the side of the road, got out of his vehicle, walked to the back of his car, and removed the bumper sticker from off his bumper. Got back into his car, continued to go 20 miles over the speed limit, bobbing in and out of traffic, honking his horn at people, giving them nasty looks as he passed them by. He took off his Christianity so that he can continue to break the law with a clear conscience. A similar instance, ladies and gentlemen, this is the reality of many Christians who think that their government is opposing God. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, when you and I think that our government, in which we are citizens of, when they do something that we think is in opposition to God, when they say something that we think is opposed to God, when they do something that we simply do not like, we do what this pastor did. Instead of upholding our Christianity, we pull off our Christianity to oppose our government. But I stood up this morning to let somebody somewhere know that God expects both you and I to submit ourselves unto those whom he has placed in authority over us. I hear what you're saying, brother, reverend, pastor, preacher. You mean to tell me that God wants me to submit myself unto a government, whether they are just or unjust? Why should I be submissive unto a person who has authority over me? This is the natural question that arises out of the text. Why should both you and I be submissive to a person who has authority over us? Here, in our selected text, Paul, under the unction of the Holy Spirit, makes known to us why it is that both you and I should be submissive to people or to a person who has authority over us. First, we should be submissive to a person who has authority over us because God uses authorities to punish disobedience. God uses authorities to punish disobedience. If you graced us with your presence approximately 2 weeks ago, then you would have heard me preach a sermon entitled, No Justice, No Peace. It was inside that little sermon that the question was raised, how can you be at peace with everyone? And if you took good notes prayerfully, you learned that you can be at peace with everyone if you be kind to people who are not like you. Not only can you be at peace with everyone if you be kind to people who are not like you, but you can also be at peace with everyone when you are united with people who are like you. Not only can you be at peace with everyone by being kind to people who are not like you and being united with people who are like you, but ultimately you can be at peace with everyone when you are aware that justice ultimately belongs to God. It's based on that argument that Paul eases his way into Romans chapter 13, particularly verses 1 and 2, by encouraging, by commanding each and every one of us to submit ourselves unto the authorities that God has placed over us. Paul says in the text, every person is to be in subjection unto the governing authorities. Let me preface this point by reminding you that the book of Romans consists of 16 chapters. In chapters 1 through 11, Paul gives us doctrine. He gives us doctrine to try to encourage non-believers to become believers, and he gives us doctrine to try to strengthen the faith of those of us who are already believers. But when Paul gets to chapters 12 through 16, Paul is not giving us necessarily doctrine as much as Paul is trying to teach us how we are to apply the doctrine that he provided in Romans chapters 1 through 11. Here's what I'm trying to get you to understand. If you are not a Christian, based on Romans chapters 1 through 11, then Romans chapters 12 through 16 won't help you. Paul says, we believers, every soul, Paul is writing to believers, we believers, every soul is to be, this is a command, ladies and gentlemen, we are to be in subjection, Paul says, to the governing authorities. The Greek word for subjection here means, based on the context of the passage, it can either mean to obey
or it can mean to be submissive to. Let me give it to you again. The Greek word that Paul uses for subjection here, depending on the context of the passage in which you are reading, can either mean to be obedient to, or it can mean to be submissive to. I know what you're thinking. Brother, Reverend, Pastor, Preacher, what's the difference between obedience and submission? I'm glad you're asking all the right questions this morning. When someone tells you to be obedient, they are not leaving you with an option to be disobedient. But when someone tells you to be submissive, they are then giving you the option to whether or not you want to obey or whether you want to disobey the person you are asked to be submissive to. Paul is not telling us to obey our government. He's telling us to submit ourselves to our government. In other words, Paul is giving us a choice of whether or not we want to obey or whether we want to disobey. Ultimately, ladies and gentlemen, you are required to obey your government. But when your government does something that is in direct opposition to what you believe as a Christian, you then have the option to disobey. But here, Paul, you have the option to obey. You have the option to disobey, but you have to deal with the consequences of your choice. Government authorities exist because God lets them exist. Paul says, every person is to be in subjection to the governing authorities, for there is no authority that exists without God. Do you see that? Whether the authority is doing what is pleasing in the eyesight of God, or whether the authority is not doing what's pleasing in the eyesight of God, Paul says either way, both of them exist because God allows them to exist. And if God allows a person to be in authority over you, you ought to submit yourself unto that authority. This is not popular preaching to African American people, because we have a habit of putting our guards up, tearing off our Christianity to stand up for what we think is right. Paul does not support that theology. Paul says, you have the choice to obey and you have the choice to disobey. But keep in mind that there are consequences for your actions. You want to disobey, fine, but be prepared to deal with the consequences that come with disobedience. Let me say that again. You want to disobey, fine, but be prepared to deal with the consequences of your disobedience. Paul says that God has ordained authorities, whether you think they are good authorities or whether you think they are bad authorities. Paul says they are ordained by God. And look what Paul says. Therefore, verse 2, whoever resists authorities has opposed the ordinance of God. You know, but the phrase ordinance of God is, we use it in church, we call it ordination. Generally speaking, when we talk about a person being ordained, we're talking about a person inside of the church who is being ordained. But Paul uses the ordinance of God not to refer to church office, but he uses the phrase ordinance of God to refer to civil government. Paul says that people in government have been ordained by God. God has appointed them to the office in which they are serving. This doesn't make sense to you, does it? Because your question is, why would God allow somebody in office to do what they are doing? Listen, the government works for God. God does not work for the government. Okay, if you're taking notes, that's a good place to write something down. I don't care who is in office, whether they are good or whether they are bad. You can bet your life on it that God has placed them there to do his will, not their own. They may think that they are in charge. They may look like they are in charge, but God is the one who gave them the job. And the last I checked, the one who gives you the job is your boss. Paul says, whoever opposes these authorities oppose the ordinance of God. You might think that you are opposing who you have a problem with. But Paul says, no, you ain't opposing me. You opposing God. Because whether you think that a leader is good or whether you think a leader is bad, Paul plainly states here in the text that God has allowed them to be what they are. Paul says the ordinance of God, if they who oppose, guess what? Paul says they will receive condemnation. Condemnation is a strong term. Some would even refer to it as a heavenly term. But Paul is not saying here that God will condemn you. Paul is saying here that the person who God has allowed to be in authority will condemn you. Where condemnation simply means to judge, it means to punish. Paul is saying, whoever God has placed in authority over you, if you make up in your mind that you want to oppose them, God has given them the go-ahead to punish you. This means, ladies and gentlemen, that you have a choice to make. Your choice can either be to obey or submit to the people that God has placed in office, or your choice can be to disobey the people that God has placed in office. Paul leaves the door open. The choice is yours. But Paul warns you, be careful, because the person whom God has placed in office, God has given them the authority to punish disobedience. Authorities are for the benefit of people who are good. Paul says, and they who oppose will receive condemnation upon themselves. God has used authority. God uses authority to punish disobedience. Exodus chapter 1, verse number 8 validates for us that God uses authorities to punish disobedience. You know it, don't you? Exodus chapter 1, verse 8, text says, there arose a king who knew not Joseph. Joseph, you know Joseph, don't you? That Israelite who saved not only Egypt, but he saved the entire world from the 7 years of famine. And after all that Joseph had done for Egypt and that all that Joseph had done for the this will die. The king, who knew not Joseph, thought he had a wise plan. We're going to put the Israelites in Egypt, and we're going to keep them in bondage. We're going to oppress them. We're going to put our foot on their necks. But God said, you think you're doing something, don't you? You work for me. I don't work for you. God allows the king to put the Israelites into slavery. He allows Pharaoh to rise up and think he's still running the show. When Moses stands before Pharaoh and says, God said, let my people go. Pharaoh says, who is this God? Pharaoh forgot who he worked for. And when it looked like the government had the upper hand, when it looked like the government was overriding God, God said, I'm just using these authorities to set the stage for me to open up the Red Sea. I'm just using these authorities to set the stage for me to rain down manna from heaven. I'm just using these authorities to set the stage to show you that I am God. God uses authorities. This is why, ladies and gentlemen, you should submit yourself to authorities. Because God uses them to do his will. Not only, ladies and gentlemen, must you be submissive to a person who has authority over you, because God uses them to punish disobedience. But secondly, you should be submissive to a person who has authority over you because God uses them to maintain order. In verses 1 and 2, Paul commands us to submit ourselves unto those people whom God has placed over us. But in verses 3, 4, and 5, Paul explains why we should submit ourselves to those people whom God has placed over us. Paul says, for rulers are not a cause of fear for good behavior, but for evil. Do you want to be afraid of authority? No. Well, do what is good. Paul, in Colossians chapter number 3, somewhere around verses 18 through 22, Paul reveals ultimately who it is that you and I serve when we submit ourselves to the ones that God has allowed to be over us. Colossians chapter 3, verse 18, Paul says, wives, subject yourself to your husband. Colossians chapter 3, verse 19, Paul says, husbands, love your wives. Colossians chapter 3, verse 21, Paul says, children, obey your parents. Colossians chapter 3, verse 22, Paul says, slaves, obey your masters. Do you see the order that Paul tries to explain there? Paul says when a woman is doing her job, and when a man is doing his job, and when children are doing their jobs, and when slaves are doing their jobs, everything works together in order. But God sets up authorities so that when anyone decides that they want to disrupt the order, God uses authorities to bring things back together. Paul says, you need authorities. I see how you're looking. You don't think you need them, do you? You know right from wrong, don't you? A kid knows right from wrong, but every once in a while, they do something that is absolutely, positively wrong, and God gives them a parent to bring them back in order. In the same way, ladies and gentlemen, authorities keep things in order. And when things get out of order, God has set up authorities to bring you back in place. Yes, Paul is talking about government here, but allow me to talk about the church for just a second. God has not only set up authorities in households, God has not only set up authorities in the world, but God has set up authorities inside the church. And anytime that somebody in the church does something out of order, God has placed authority to bring things back to order. Problem with the church is we too independent. Can't nobody tell me. I'm gonna do what I want to do. I'm gonna say what I want to say. I show up when I want to show up. They lucky I came. They lucky I didn't come. Now the kids are. This is why I preface the message by saying, if you are not a Christian, Paul ain't talking to you. Because a Christian has respect for the authorities that God has set up. A Christian understands that God has ordained authorities. Whether I agree with that authority or whether I disagree with that authority, if God has something to do with them, I trust that God is working things out for my good. Paul says, for rulers are not a cause of fear for those who are good. You don't have no need to be afraid of the government when you're doing what you are supposed to do. I travel 45 south and north every day. When I'm in a rush and I'm going 2 miles over the speed limit, I'm constantly looking over my shoulder, checking my rearview mirror to see if there are some authorities that's ready to discipline me. But as long as I'm on time and I'm going the speed limit, I got my seatbelt on, my insurance ain't expired, my tags are up to date, I don't care where the authorities are. In fact, when they pull up on the side of me, I go ahead and wave at because you don't have anything to worry about. Paul says the authorities, God didn't set up authorities for you to be afraid of it, especially if you are doing what is right. If you're doing what is right, Paul says, the authorities will praise you. Did you get that? If you are doing what is right, those whom God has put in place to be over you, Paul says, they will give you praise. But there's no praise for people who make up in their mind that they want to do what they want to do. No praise for that. Paul says, in authority, verse 4, is a minister of God. That's weird language to apply to a government official outside of the church. Paul says that they are a minister of God. The phrase minister of God refers to a person who benefits other people. They work for God for the benefit of you and I. Listen, if the authorities are not doing their job by maintaining order, then we would not have the opportunity to have this service. But because God has set up authorities to maintain order, there is nobody running in on us, disrupting the service of God. Paul says, authorities, government officials, They are doing the will of God. They are serving God by serving us. They're ministers of God to you for good. Do you see my favorite three-letter contrasting conjunction there? But if you do what's evil, be afraid. For God has not set up a ruler to have a sword for nothing. A sword is not literal here. It's very figurative. It is very metaphorical. A sword refers to an executing utensil. Paul says that God has given authorities the power, the ability to execute judgment on those who try to disrupt what God has ordained. Listen, you ain't got to be afraid of nobody who thinks that they are going to disrupt what God has ordained. If God has ordained it, God will make sure that his will goes forward. This is the reason that God has set up authorities, to make sure that order is maintained. Authorities, God has given them the power to enforce capital punishment, whether you agree with capital punishment or not. God has ordained the authorities to put people in prison so that you don't have to be afraid of your house getting broken into. God has ordained authorities to exercise their authorities in the streets so that you can go to bed at night. God has allowed authorities to exercise their power so that you and I could walk around in this world and be at peace. At any time somebody wants to disrupt the peace, and any time that somebody wants to disrupt the service, at any time somebody wants to do something to oppose what God has ordained, God says, I have given authorities the power to execute judgment. They do not bear the sword for nothing. They do not bear the sword for nothing. God uses authorities to maintain order. Not only should you be submissive, not only should you be submissive to a person that God has placed over you because God uses authorities to punish disobedience, and God uses authorities to maintain order, but lastly, I'm in my seat, you to be submissive to a person who God has placed in authority over you, because God uses authorities to perform his desires. Verses 6 and 7. Paul commands us to maintain and respect those whom God has placed over us. Paul says in verse 6, for because of this, for this reason, because God uses authorities to punish disobedience, and because God uses authorities to maintain order, Paul says, this is why both you and I pay taxes. You didn't know this kind of stuff was in the Bible, did you? You thought paying taxes was wrong, didn't you? You thought taxes was a substitute for your tithes, didn't you? You thought taxes was a substitute for you giving unto the church, didn't you? Well, they take 10% out of my check every week. So that means I ain't got to do nothing for nobody else. Paul says, no. Paul says, for this reason, you pay taxes. Paul uses two terms here. In verse 6, he uses the term pay taxes. In verse 7, he uses the term customs.
Let's deal with what it means to pay taxes.
Pay taxes means a payment that sustains the government. We need government. God has ordained government. And because God has ordained government, God has provided a way to sustain the government. The government benefits both you and I. And since we are the beneficiaries of the government, it is our obligation to sustain what is helping us. Paul says you pay taxes to sustain the government. But in verse 7, Paul says you pay custom to sustain the governor.
To sustain the government and to sustain the governor are essentially two different things. I don't have time to get into all the history of what a tax was in Paul's day and what a custom was in Paul's day, but suffice it to say that taxes sustain the government, but customs paid the governor. We have a twofold obligation. We have an obligation to sustain our government, and we have an obligation to sustain the person who is in government. Which means that they are employed by God. They are paid by us. Very similar to the Old Testament Levitical priesthood. God calls the priest to do nothing but sit in the temple and service the people. And this is where the phrase tithe comes into play, because the priests and the Levites could do nothing but serve the people. The people brought their offerings to the temple because God had set up an ordinance that would not only support the temple, but it would sustain the priest. We don't have priests and Levites. There's no need for a tithe, but that is an argument for a different day. Paul says God has set up government the same way. God uses the government to benefit